Your Steve Jones Show podcast will start shortly. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Brewers Outlet, your beverage supermarket on Reagan Street in Sunbury. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good Friday afternoon, everybody. Great to have you with us here on News Radio 1070 WKOK, and every Friday brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. All right, gang, here it's simple. We know it's going to snow this weekend, so stock up now. You want to make sure that with, tomorrow being a big snow day, all right, you're going to have to probably clear the driveway, clear the sidewalk, whatever. You know what? Then Sunday, you want to kick back and watch some football. The AFC and NFC Championship Game starting at 3 o'clock. You know what? You want to probably put a fire in the fireplace or the wood stove, whatever it may be. You want to just kick back, turn the game on, have plenty of beverages. And Brewers Outlet's your one-stop shopping. The best selection of beer anywhere. Wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks. And don't forget, imports, domestics, and microbrews. And then I mentioned the water, the wine cooler, the snacks. And the peanuts are roasted fresh and hot every day. The bags are right there at the register. And the pickle bar, yes, led by the barrels and the dills. I mean, really, can you get through a game without a barrel or a dill? Come on. I know I can't. The pickle bar is indeed second to none. All at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. I'm in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. The best product, and they've got a wide variety, best sales staff, and they're looking to make deals with you, trying to fit your budget, your lifestyle, and the best service department. It's Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. So when this is over with, I go to Minnesota tonight. So for the second consecutive big storm, I'm going to be out of town. The other one was back in November. Remember, I was in Chicago doing the shows. And when I was doing the show in Chicago, it was a Thursday. And the game was Thursday night with DePaul. And the plan was when the game was over, I would fly back to State College, get back maybe about midnight, 1, something like that. Probably about 1 in the morning we'd get back. And then I'd get on the football bus and go to Rutgers the next day about 11:30. Okay, great. I woke up Thursday morning in Chicago and I looked at the forecast. And I thought, State College looks like it's going to be bad. I don't think we're going to get back. So about 8 o'clock Thursday morning. Now, again, this is before the game. I got a hold of Dick Girardi. He said, Dick, I said, what's your flight back to Philly look like? And he goes, well, I'm on Southwest flight tomorrow morning to Newark. I said, good. I said, I'm booking that flight. So I got the flight number from Dick. Booked the flight from State College, Newark, 12 hours before the game. Because I thought, I am not going to get stuck there. I have to be at Rutgers to do the football game on Saturday. Well, that turned out to be a wise move. The basketball team did not leave for State College until 4:30 that Friday afternoon. So I would have gotten back probably about 5:30, 6 o'clock. I'd say 6 o'clock and would have had to have driven after that. So that was a prudent move. Now the next gigantic storm comes in. We've had all these little mini ones, okay, that rolled through, including last night. And I'm in Minnesota tomorrow. And I don't think we're getting back till Sunday. All right. Let's talk some football with Neal Coolong. Later in the show, Nora Princiotti on the Patriots. We're going to talk to Dick Girardi about basketball and Jeff Byers at 4:06 talking Penn State wrestling. They've got Nebraska Sunday at 1. We'll come back, talk with Neal in a moment as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Welcome back on this Friday, the calm before the storm. Be ready for it, okay? Just be ready and take it easy during the storm. Just take it easy. And when I mean take it easy, you know what? You know, take care of the driveway, the sidewalk, whatever you need to take care of, and then just kick back and enjoy some of the beverages at Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. Stock up today, all right? Best of imports, domestics, microbrews, wine coolers, water, soft drinks, snacks, lots of snacks. They roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. The Pickle Bar, led by the Barrels and the Dills, all together now. Yes, you in Turbotville, second to none. Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Still to come on today's show, in the next half hour, Nora Princiotti of the Boston Globe on the AFC Championship game tomorrow night between the Patriots and the Kansas City Chiefs. Then Jeff Byers will join us in the 4 o'clock half hour to preview Penn State wrestling. I went through 8 weight classes yesterday. In those 8 weight classes, Penn State is 114-3. Wow. They'll take on 7th-ranked Nebraska, scheduled for 1 o'clock Sunday in Rec Hall. Keep in mind, hockey's already made a change. Hockey will play at 7 tonight with Ohio State. Ohio State's ranked 4th in the country. But the Saturday game with Ohio State is now going to be a puck drop at 3 o'clock, trying to stay ahead of the storm. All right? So just make note of that if you're a big hockey fan. But we'll have Jeff Byers in the 4 o'clock half hour on Penn State wrestling and Dick Girardi on college basketball in the final half hour today. Let's bring in Neal Coolong now from USA Today. Obviously, Neal, there's been a lot of movement. The NFL draft is the declaration day for the NFL draft. The last day was Tuesday. So for everybody out there, as we sit here now on the 18th of January, nobody else can declare for the NFL draft. Tuesday was the last day you can do it. So if you're wondering, okay, what's going to happen with Windsor? What's going to happen with Reed? Hey, look, you know, they haven't declared. They're staying, all right? I've had people ask me about both those guys. So Kyler Murray, though, who's in an interesting spot, 9th overall pick in the Major League Baseball draft by the Oakland A's, $4.66 million signing bonus to sign with the A's, but now is declared for the NFL draft. So, Neil, I want to get your assessment. What do you think of Kyler Murray entering the draft and the kind of quarterback he is?
You know, I'll say this first. The one thing I really enjoy about the job that I have is it requires me to have to dive in very quickly and learn rules of something that I didn't know the day before.
Yeah.
Getting back into Major League Baseball contracts and how all that stuff works, I had to call like 50 different people to really get a feel for who Kyler Murray was as a baseball prospect.
Right.
For me, I think that's where this situation is ultimately going to be determined. Watching him on a football field, I'll be honest with you, this is the real wrench in the gear of the whole thing for him. I think I need to see another year from him in football. He doesn't have that time.
No.
And I think that's why he's probably pushing the way he is. He has to make a decision now based on what he feels. And I don't think he's going to know truly which is best for him for at least another year. I want to see another year of him on the field, football-wise.
Right.
He threw from a pristine pocket. He's got a nice arm. He threw a lot of stuff straight down the middle, which to me, that's not great quarterback play. That's much more design. It's much more just pure arm strength when you're throwing against air. There's nothing there,
and
really.
And I'd like to point out, it was against a lot of those were Big 12 defenses.
Yeah, I mean, you see it. It's not that he doesn't make good throws.
Right,
he doesn't, you know, see this. It's good. You know, you can't take anything away from him, but
no.
It's like, I didn't see any adversity. I didn't see really.
Until Alabama, yeah.
What's he doing when he's getting beat on? What's he doing when his receivers aren't 5 yards wide open? What kind of player is that? That's the NFL prospect. It's not how good you were in college, obviously. It's how he's responding to what a high-level defense is putting on him. And I don't know if I saw that enough this year to say I want him in the first round. Somebody will end up taking him in the first round because, frankly, you're not going to be able to convince him to not play baseball unless you make him a first-round pick.
Right.
So anyone who wants him is going to have to take him in the first round. It's a weird segment of what the draft is turning into with the quarterback position.
Well, Scott Boras is his agent. Does Scott Boras have any football clients?
He doesn't.
I didn't think so. He's always been a baseball guy, and that is his agent is Scott Boras. Now, I know they've had to deal with Drew Rosenhaus before, but the NFL's never seen anybody like Scott Boras.
Yeah, if you're Scott Boras, though, right now, you're chewing Rolaids tabs like crazy. I mean, this whole thing just makes him look – teams are going to have a real tough time dealing with him in the future when it comes to the amateur guys. The pro guy, your Bryce Harper's, no problem.
Yeah.
He'll get what he wants. But for the amateur guys, the Oakland A's look really, really bad right now. Yeah. In the end, you had to look at it and evaluate it. There were plenty of people saying this kid, you know, last June, this kid is a Heisman Trophy candidate. He legitimately could do that. You're paying him $4.5 million, which isn't really all that much in the grand scheme, but that's a big investment for a baseball team.
Sure it is.
You know, the first-round pick doesn't mean anything compared to what it does in the NFL, but that's a sizable investment they're giving him that day without expecting him to play for probably 3-4 years minimum.
Right.
And he's not going to be that young when he gets into baseball. That's really the issue I'd have with him. As a general manager of an NFL team, what I want to know is from Kyler Murray, why are you not going to do to me what you just did to Billy Beane in the A's? Yeah. I want to know that before I take him in the first round. I don't know. I'll be honest with you. I really don't know. This is going to be crazy. This will be the story of the offseason.
I mean, there's going to be a risk because he has, I mean, what's the golden word in every negotiation? He has leverage. And you know, even though in baseball there is a cap on bonus money that can be paid out. I want to say the cap, Neil, is like $7 million. So he got 4.66 of it. That $7 million is for all the prospects combined. He got 4.66 of it. All right. And the NFL, of course, has a rookie salary scale. Well, that doesn't extend to the bonus. The key is going to be if they can come up with an astronomical bonus that doesn't work against the cap, that might be what swings it.
They can't. They're stuck. I mean, whatever slot he gets picked in, pretty much that's going to be his bonus. But at the same time, a first-round quarterback, a first-round pick in general, let's say outside of the top 10, make it easy for now. His fifth-year option is essentially the transition tag in the NFL. For a quarterback, that's like $18 million. And I can't even imagine what it's going to be after 4 years when, in this hypothetical situation, Murray were to get to that point. They're going to hang on to him for a lot of money. He will make way more money as a quarterback and a first-round pick in the NFL than he was a baseball player, period. But the difference between Lamar Jackson and whoever was taken 33rd last year is astronomical.
Yes.
That's the risk that he has. He has to gamble on the idea that there will be a team wanting to lock into him for that long. And again, if you're a general manager of a team, what assurance do you have? Keep in mind, he's not a running back. He's a quarterback. Yeah. That's a huge investment in the first round.
Oh, I know. Well,
I don't know. I see both sides of it. I think it's nuts. This is going to get interesting.
I want to say it was 1982. Stefan Wisniewski, who plays for the Eagles, his dad, Leo, was here at Penn State. And I want to say the New Orleans Saints, for some odd reason, had to forfeit a first-round pick. And at this time, I don't know, I want to say there were eight teams in the NFL at this point. So the Colts, I think it was the 83 draft, the one they opened up with Elway. Well, they also had the first pick of the second round, which was 28. So Leo Wisniewski got picked 28th. And his agent said, hey, yo, there's 28 teams. Don't we get first-round money? And they're like, no. Hersey's like, no, that's not how it works.
They did away with a lot of that for that very reason. Same thing happened with Drew Brees. Keep in mind, Drew Brees was the last first second-round pick to be taken before the Texans came into the league. So technically he was the 32nd overall pick, but first in the second round. So a lot of the history was built on that kind of thing. And what eventually got them to slotting the process the way they have it now is because of those kinds of things. But Murray, he's going to blow a lot of this stuff away. And from his perspective, I don't know. I think in the end, he'd be better served playing both for one more year. And that's my opinion. I've seen him play baseball. I know more about football than I do about baseball. But you watch him, you can see some skill there. And there's not really a whole lot of defensive tape that's available. People I've talked to don't suggest he's a real high-end defensive center fielder. But
he's fast.
There's enough there.
He covers ground.
Obviously. He's a phenomenal athlete. We've seen the arm on a football field. You can throw a football. You can throw a baseball. You have to imagine that's there to some degree. But the biggest issue in my mind with him is with baseball, you need at-bats. Yeah. You need reps.
And that's
we don't
issue.
Know how good of him anymore.
Right.
So he's 21. He hasn't played the game for all that long.
Right.
For me, it'd be more like, well, let's throw another even crazier wrinkle into it. You want to know the biggest reason why he's talking about the draft now? There are no quarterbacks in this draft.
No.
They all, for whatever reason, decided to wait until next year to go into the draft.
Haskins, so, Jones, and Locke are the other three guys. I mean, you're not exactly blown away by them.
Yeah, he's getting passed up next year. All things being equal, if next year's scenario with quarterbacks in the NFL draft same right now, he's getting passed over. He's not experienced enough as a lot of those guys.
Yeah,
he doesn't have the time on the field. Other people are going to go elsewhere. And again, considering his situation, he's up against a huge bonus in baseball for his decision. He has to take a pretty significant risk that he is absolutely going to be a first round pick.
Yeah,
I don't know if anyone else has had that kind of a gamble before. It's fascinating overall, but I think my gut instinct, I think he's more of a football player. I think he has to play more. And ironically, I don't think he's going to get that by being a first round pick this year, because he's going to have to go top 10 to do that. He's going to have to beat out the kid from Ohio State to be the Giants' next quarterback. He's going to have to beat out that kid from Duke that's played a bunch in a great pro system. That's a big gamble for him to take. I don't know. He's in a tough spot. He's in a real tough spot.
You know, it's interesting, though. Sometimes when they see less of you, it leaves more to the imagination. You and I both know there are a lot of GMs that have very vivid imaginations.
He's going to have to bank on that because, frankly, that I promise you, that's what it'll be. Whatever team that takes him in the first round, they're banking on what they think he could be eventually but have not seen on film. And that's not something teams do with quarterbacks very often.
The one tape I'd look at over and over again would be Alabama. He made some plays with his legs. He made some plays with his arm. But he was harassed all night, and Oklahoma did, I mean, yeah, they did some stuff in the second half. But, I mean, when Alabama had to put the foot to the accelerator to the floor, right, okay, his body was in the way, and they just crushed it. I mean.
Yep. Yep, and that's what I mean. In the bulk of his film is like, wow, these guys just aren't playing defense at all.
The bulk of his film is Iowa State. I mean, okay, come on. Neil, always a pleasure. You know, we always talk about fits being important, and this may really disturb you, but you fit with this show.
Steelers take Kyler Murray at 20. That'd set my ear for sure.
We'll have that convo. The Steelers take Kyler Murray at 20. We're going to do a 10-part series.
Oh man, that would be the most non-Steeler move ever. And it could happen because we've seen a bunch of non-Steelers moves. Yeah. Nothing they do anymore is anything we're used to.
Yeah,
fun stuff. We love it.
Any team that takes Artie Burns in the first round, you do have to have some questions.
He even makes a team next year. Let's talk about that next week. You're even on the roster next year. Is there a point anymore?
That is a good question. All right. Thanks so much, my friend. Great to have you, Neil.
Definitely. Thanks for having me, guys.
Neal Coolong. Next half hour, Nora Princiotti of the Boston Globe as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Sunbury Motors Hyundai has the brand new Hyundai you deserve with savings of over $7,000. Buy a $25,000 2018 Santa Fe for only $18,259. That's a savings of over $7,000. A 2018 Hyundai Elantra is discounted to an unbelievable $14,810. Sunbury Motors Hyundai has a 2018 Santa Fe Sport that was $34,890 and now only $28,840. Hyundai comes with America's best 10-year 100,000-mile power train warranty. No matter what size SUV you're looking for, Sunbury Motors has it. 2019 Hyundai Konas, only $23,210. 2019 Hyundai Tucson, only $21,110. 2019 Santa Fes, only $26,775. And the 2019 Santa Fe XL starts under $30,000. Now is the time to get the new Hyundai you deserve. From Sunbury Motors Hyundai in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right, great to have you with us today. On this calm before the storm, a little mini Clipper move through last night, and then, of course, the big one coming up this weekend, so just be prepared for it. And part of being prepared is to make sure you're fully stocked. That means going to Brewer's Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. If you enjoy beer, they have the best selection of beer anywhere. Imports, domestics, microbrews. Maybe enjoy a wine cooler. Water, soft drinks, snacks. Lots of snacks. All right. And they roast their peanuts fresh and hot every day. The pickle bar led by the barrels and the dills, indeed second to none. Hey, stock up. I mean, you know, just kick back, watch the NFC and AFC championship games on Sunday, knowing you're fully stocked, and like look at the outside and go, yeah, it snowed, so what? All at Brewer's Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Still to come on the show today. Next hour, and the next half hour, in fact, at 4:06, we will have Jeff Byers on Penn State Wrestling. We'll talk with him. In the final half hour, Dick Girardi on college basketball. This half hour, Nora Princiotti of the Boston Globe previewing the AFC Championship game, which is the nightcap between the Patriots and the Chiefs. Very quickly, this day in sports history, 1886, the Hockey Association was formed in England. This date is the birthday of modern field hockey. 1981, the NFL passed a rule that a tackle, guard, or center was not eligible to catch a forward pass. 1958, Willie O'Ree made his NHL debut with the Boston Bruins. He became the first black player to enter the league. The NHL All-Star Game was held for the first time in 1967. In 1969, Ted Williams was appointed manager of the Washington Senators. Williams actually is a pretty good manager. Actually did a pretty good job. The Steelers beat the Dallas Cowboys 21-17 in Super Bowl X for Jack Ham and the Steelers, their second consecutive Super Bowl victory. They say 80 million people watched it. Baseball owners, 1996, unanimously approved interleague play for 1997. 1998, the Celtics retired Robert Parrish's double zero. And in 2002, a pair of NHL records held by the great Bobby Hull were broken in a game between the Red Wings and the Capitals. Luke Robitaille scored his 611th goal to pass Hull, and Brett Hull, Bobby's son, scored his 99th game-winning goal to pass Dad. All right. Chiefs and Patriots, the nightcap on CBS, and you'll hear it here on Westwood One and WKOK. Nora Princiotti of the Boston Globe joins us to preview the game. Nora, thanks so much for your time. We appreciate it. And thanks for joining us on the show today.
Sure thing, Steve. Thanks for having me.
Nora, these two teams played earlier in the year, and it was quite an offensive show, and it was a terrific and entertaining game. But you and I both know that teams change as the season goes. Where have the Patriots changed, in your opinion, since that night?
Well, one thing that I think could end up being significant is that their secondary looks pretty different from how it did in week six. You know, in that game, Eric Rowe and Jonathan Jones both played significant snaps at corner. Now we're seeing Stephon Gilmore, obviously, who, you know, was a starter in that matchup too, but he's still there, obviously. But then it's Jason McCourty and J.C. Jackson, who's an undrafted rookie who has played phenomenally, broke into the starting lineup and hasn't relinquished it because he's just been, I mean, an incredible, particularly just in terms of ball skills, being able to defend the deep part of the field. He's been as good as Gilmore since he jumped into a larger role. So that, you know, just because it gives the Patriots two guys and a third with Jason McCourty, who's played well, who can really handle some of these top receivers man-to-man, if that's what they're asked to do, I think that could significantly change things just in terms of having a super, you know, high-flying, both teams scoring in the 40s in that first matchup type of game.
Well, what's interesting is if you and I were to sit down in October and talk about, all right, the high-scoring teams in the NFL, the Saints, the Rams, the Chiefs, yet the highest-scoring team over this past weekend happened to be the Patriots. They're the only ones that cracked 40 points. They had 41. What have you seen from the offensive line and also now Sony Michel's feel for working with that offensive line?
Well, so they're really good. And to be clear, just so that it doesn't sound like I'm, you know, being too kind to the team that I cover here, I would say that if you wanted to pinpoint the strengths of this team, I would start with the offensive line and the secondary, the two things that we've just talked about here. And, I mean, Sony, for a rookie, has been really good. There were a couple games where, you know, in part because they were just asking too much of him and the other parts of the offense weren't working, so they were just too predictable. He has disappeared a couple times, but when the running game has been going well, he's been, the offense as a whole has been really good. And, you know, it seems anachronistic in today's NFL to be talking so much about the run game, but for the Patriots this season, when that's been working, that's when they've had those, you know, 40-plus point outputs like they did in the middle stretch of the season, and then again like they did against the Chargers.
All right, so, yeah, now I asked you about the Patriots. What have you observed, and, it, you know, of course, you're covering the Patriots over time, but what's been your feel for Kansas City? Because they're not putting up 40 points a game anymore either.
Yeah, and, you know, full disclosure, I would not say that I'm caught up on their film enough to really diagnose it.
Right.
It did seem like, you know, having Sammy Watkins back was potentially a good thing for them, although, you know, it's not like they were scoring 40 against the Colts either, who have a good defense. I would just say that you see a little bit of, it's hard to talk about vulnerabilities with Mahomes because he's incredible, but, you know, he can be a little erratic, a little bit of a risk taker, sometimes in ways that are delightful and other times in ways that make you think, okay, the Patriots defense, they can intercept passes. That's one strength. You know, this defense isn't perfect, but like I said, I think the secondary is good, and particularly with Jackson and Gilmore, you know, those are two guys who have elite ball skills. So taking what I've seen from them over the last chunk of the season and last week when the offense hasn't looked quite as unbelievable as it was in the middle of the season, you wonder if that's an area where the Patriots feel like they match up favorably, and that was something I actually just got out of the locker room like an hour ago, and Daron Harmon, one of their safeties, said that in pretty clear terms, that they feel like, you know, even with Watkins, Tyreek Hill, who's probably the most dynamic explosive weapon in football, they feel like they match up pretty well against this passing offense. So I will certainly be watching that, and it could go either way. That's the fun thing about these kind of strength-on-strength battles, but I do think the Patriots have, relatively speaking to where other teams would feel going against that group, some confidence.
Well, let me put it this way. I don't think it was a coincidence that the Chargers played so much better against the Ravens after seeing them 3 weeks earlier and getting a handle on how Lamar Jackson and John Harbaugh want to run that particular offense. The second time through meant a lot. When you talk to the Patriots players, they've now seen Mahomes. They've now seen how they had Kareem Hunt that night, too. But, you know, how much do you feel that they are helped because this is the second time around against them and now they know what he can and can't do?
Well, that typically is a situation that works in the Patriots' favor. Belichick, obviously, you know, with more time to scout an opponent's tendencies, he tends to do pretty well in those situations. I don't think Andy Reid's bad there either. You know, I mean, he's had so much success after bye weeks, which I think in some ways is it's a little similar just because in both cases you collectively have more time that you're putting into preparing an opponent, even if, you know, it was earlier in the season and then now. So I don't think, you know, I think both teams can use that. I think with Mahomes and with some of the guys like Hill, you know, Belichick said something funny today where someone asked him a question about kind of how do you coach your players to get ready for someone with Tyreek Hill's speed. You have to do different things in practice, and he just kind of he said something like, "What do you mean? Can we get someone in practice to be as fast as him?" Which, of course, the answer is no.
If they could, Nora, he'd be playing.
Right, exactly. And my point, which I'm sort of rambling towards, being that it's great and all to have a good sense of what they're able to do. The problem is, it's darn good what they're able to do, and you still have to stop it. And, you know, some of the throws that Mahomes can make, obviously the speed, it's really hard to prepare for, even if you know that it's coming. It's really hard to stop, even when you know that it's coming. So I think there's a limit to how much just sort of the mental stuff and that kind of execution can always help you against a team like the Chiefs. But obviously, it's important because I think they know that the Chiefs are going to make some plays. It's almost a given that they're going to. And then when you couple that with, you know, okay, Tyreek Hill is going to have a couple explosive plays, but then if you also give him a couple more easy ones because of coverage breakdowns, then you're in a bad situation. So the point is limiting it to pretty much just the plays where all you can do is tip your cap. And, you know, you'll feel fairly confident that the Patriots are going to be able to run on this Chiefs defense and hopefully bleed the clock if you're Josh McDaniels, you know, put together some long drives, put your defense in a good situation. And, you know, I don't think they want to be thinking about playing keep away in terms of an individual drive. But over the course of the game, I think they would like to have a kind of possession advantage, keep Mahomes off the field, tire out the run defense so that as the game wears on, they're able to be even more successful in that area, which really has been the recipe for them all season when they've been successful.
Fans think and notice everything. The official for Sunday's game was also the alternate official for the Colts-Patriots championship game, and we all know what game that was. It is Cleet Blakeman. Are you surprised that Twitter is blowing up with the fact, especially in New England, about the fact that he has been assigned to be the lead official for the game on Sunday?
I haven't been on Twitter enough. I hadn't even seen that. That's very funny, I'm sure. I mean, the internet can have a good time with anything, as we've seen with all these Adam Gase memes that are going around. But that's pretty funny. I'll have to go see who had the best
news
about that.
Yeah, you'll have to see it. It's a long list. The fans noticed right away. There aren't many people on the face of the earth who know who the alternate official is ever. Ever.
That's true.
I have not asked you a question. I haven't asked you any questions yet about Gronk or about Tom Brady. When you watch Tom Brady in this particular year, do you think there are some subtle adjustments, Nora, that he's made to his game to allow him to continue to be effective, but do so in a 41-year-old version of Tom Brady?
So actually, no, I don't really think that. It's been an interesting year for Brady. I think what's become a little bit more clear is that he had a knee injury that was kind of bugging him for a few weeks. When they ran a trick play where he was supposed to catch a pass against the Titans, and he fell and he hurt himself. And
oh, geez.
At least what we've heard in the aftermath is that he banged up his knee doing that, and it was affecting him slightly, but potentially you know, in a meaningful way, even if he was still able to play with it, for the later part of the season, and it's only, you know, in the last couple of weeks and then really over the bye when he felt fully healthy again. And it did look for a chunk of the season like he might be hurt, not really in the way that he was throwing the football, because even if he was a little bit less consistent, he could still make kind of Brady-esque right. throws. Mm-hmm. But he was rolling away from pressure, particularly to his left side, a lot. And that was something that we were noticing and thinking, like, this is abnormal. And at first you wonder, is this a 41-year-old quarterback who, you know, knows that the division is not going to put up a big fight and that he can get to the playoffs and maybe he doesn't want to take hits until he absolutely has to? But then now it seems more likely to me, at least, that, you know, if he was dealing with an MCL injury, which is what we've been told is the case, then that's probably the explanation. That's the more likely explanation. So okay. I would like to see him do it another week in a row to feel more confident in that. But that's what it seems like to me, because really all season it's the consistency that hasn't quite been there. It hasn't been that, you know, his ability has changed in any kind of wholesale way.
Finally, I have to ask you about Rob Gronkowski. We talked about the running game. There were times it looked like he was the sixth offensive lineman out there. Where do you think he stands right now? Because obviously his body has been so banged up over the years.
Yeah, well, I think it's kind of a sad story, really, because I know Gronk still loves playing football, particularly when he feels good. But he doesn't always feel good at this point. And he's not like Brady. He doesn't get the same, you know, satisfaction out of eating only vegetables and spending 5 hours a day in the training room and doing all that stuff. He loves football when it feels good, but when it's a chore, when he's dragging himself, you know, onto the field and being poked and prodded and has to get all of the massages all the time, and it's everything, you know, it's such an operation, I think he loses a little bit of the joy in it. And he's been in that place at times this season where, you know, the physical ailments start to become a mental problem too, because he just doesn't feel as engaged. That said, I think you saw a player on Sunday or whatever that game was, I don't even know what day it is at this point, who was incredibly involved in the blocking game. Just had that one, you know, rumbling downfield catch, but still showed off some physical ability on that play and made an impact on the game. So is Julian Edelman their most important pass catcher on offense? Yes. Is Gronk still a factor? Also yes. And I think that with the bye, he is a little bit closer back into that space where he feels better, and that impacts obviously not just what he's able to do with his body, but it just helps him from an all-around kind of how he's feeling about playing football perspective.
Nora, it's an absolute pleasure. Thanks so much for the discussion and also for the insight.
Sure thing. Thanks for having me.
Nora Princiotti with the Boston Globe. And again, that's the nightcap. The first game tomorrow on the first game coming up on Sunday will be the Saints and the Rams at 3:05 Sunday. And you'll hear it here on WKOK, courtesy of Westwood One. And then the nightcap, also on WKOK and Westwood One, will be the Chiefs and the Patriots on Sunday night. Today's show brought to you by Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street in Sunbury, the beverage supermarket. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
Jeff Byers in the next hour on Penn State Wrestling. The undefeated Nittany Lions will take on 7th-ranked Nebraska. In Rec Hall right now scheduled for 1 on Sunday. And then the final half hour, Dick Girardi on college basketball. All right, big hour coming up. Looking forward to it. All right, hunker down. The storm's coming this weekend here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.